which I did not expect.
Stay like that.
What was your name again?
Robert.
Oh, right.
Yeah, do you
feel like that? That would be just for me. Yeah,
if I don't want to see it. Nice.
The mermaid came about when the it was from the folks in Cambridge at Fresh Pond who were doing the Alewife Brook to stop the dumping of rot sewage and toxic waste into the Alewife Brook, and they came to us and just asked if we would be willing to help them create some fish. And maybe some healthy fish, some dead fish to show. And then I created this character around, she's a mermaid in mourning for her, relatives, her underwater relatives. And then it evolved into sort of a fish funeral. And she was she was mourning along the route the whole way with all of the fish, the sadly deceased fish puppets with the X'd out eyes. And then she just evolved over time in that way. For me, it was important to have a relatable persona for people to connect to. One that didn't have to speak to get across her message. So she is pretty self-explanatory. She is caught up in netting. She has a trail of trash that she drags behind her, which adds to the spectacle, we were speaking about, for the noise that it makes. And the way, as I walk, and I walk very rhythmically, it actually creates a rhythm and a pace that is very like a funeral march. And she is, her tail is on an oil slick, so that, her tail is sort of being dragged on this oil slick, dragged behind her with plastic cut up and, trash cut in her hair. And then she has the traditional sort of mourning veil as well. And so for that, she's a spectacle that is engaging and not off-putting to the spectators, and they relate to her. She's one of the most, I feel like, connectable characters that I have created, because people really speak to her as she's walking along and attempt to communicate to her with their body language, and that is really moving for me and really meaningful, because you never know how it's going to go when you go out there, and you're not sure how people are going to, you know, look at you or consider what you're doing. But it's something that I feel a lot of people in their heart have mourning and sadness for what's happening around them. They see the water getting poisoned. They see our underwater relatives suffering. They see what's happening in all parts of Grandmother Earth. And for that, I've had a lot of people say thank you.
I mean, I've heard about climate since I was in high school, so for a long time, and I think for a while I was bought into the idea that if I followed career options to make an impact, that that would be meaningful. And so I went to school for economics and then worked in the solar industry for a long time and still work today in climate and more carbon sequestration. But through the process of working in the solar industry in Massachusetts, saw a lot of the limitations that were imposed by the state of Massachusetts on how quickly the solar industry could grow, and so started by then doing lobbying at the State House, and then was seeing a lack of response, honestly, from our politicians to accelerate solar adoption and prevent fossil fuels. And I think that going through that process of working, I mean, really for a decade of doing what people say you should do and having that not work was what led me to more of a direct action approach of meeting, you know, to try to get a bigger message out there to engage the general public in this, because it's not happening through the standard channels.
You want a prize? Yeah? We have these for you.
Wow.
It says birthday 2024. Yeah. You are the world. Yeah. Say thank you.
Our central demand as a chapter is no new fossil fuel infrastructure in Massachusetts. So that means no new generating plants running on fossil fuels. That means no new hookups. When new buildings are built, they shouldn't be built on fossil fuels. They should be built on renewable solutions. No new pipelines going through our state. And that's still happening all the time. All of those things are still happening. And including the Peabody Peaker plant being built on natural gas, about a dozen pipelines in construction, and every new building is still being hooked up to natural gas, and the state doesn't even have a plan for that. The state has a legislated goal of net zero by 2050. Like, that's law. The state is obligated to achieve that, and these infrastructure projects are planned to last for many decades, right? So if something is planned to last for 40 years and we're installing it today, you don't need to do math to know we're not going to hit our 2050 target. So we, you know, there's a lot else that needs to happen to get us off of fossil fuels, but our demand right now is just we need to stop building new infrastructure that cannot possibly be in place by 2050.
In your time, have you kind of seen any concrete results of your guys' advocacy?
That's a great question. I think that some of the specific projects that we have advocated against include the Peabody Peaker plant that I was just referencing, which is a natural gas plant that is still going forward, despite there being a lot of public resistance to the project. The Weymouth Compressor Station, which also had a lot of public resistance and has since being built, had a number of unplanned releases and continues to be resisted by the community. So I think that the state of Massachusetts has continued to allow fossil fuel projects, you know. I think that where we see more of our impact is in how the public views those issues, and we have seen a lot of response from the public, and I do think that the public has more well informed about the continued investment in fossil fuels in Massachusetts and more resistant to it.
Okay. And sorry, last question.
Yeah.
I know that you guys have obviously a very clear message and are advocating for very specific things, but this also seems like a very pleasant celebration. I mean, what do you hope to kind of accomplish by having these kinds of events, and what do you hope people take away from it?
Yeah, well, I think that one of the hardest things about the climate crisis is that, one, it's a massive scale problem, right? Like, I'm just talking about Massachusetts, but it is a global problem. And also, most of the systems, like I was saying, are non-responsive. And so that's kind of a scary premise, right? It's a massive global problem that needs action today and is not being acted on.
He bioengineered the ecosystem. Uh oh.
No.
Yeah, I think that a lot of people feel that way, right? They know that it's happening, they know that it's scary to them, but feel a lot of negativity about it and feel an inability to engage on the issue. I think for different people, different things are gonna feel good, but I do think that getting out to a party-like atmosphere event like today, like just come join us on the street and see how it feels, you know? Not everything has to be a direct confrontation with a politician. Some people are gonna find that that is more of their style. Some people, like these Red Rebels over here that are doing performance art, that performance art is their outlet for expressing how they feel about where society is right now.
Okay.
Science is under attack. What do we do?
ground.
Keep it in the ground. Keep it in the ground. Keep it in the ground. Keep it in the ground.
Keep it in the ground.
Keep it in the ground.
March was the hottest march on record, which was the 10th month in a row that made a record for that month. So, a question. Should we be expanding private jet infrastructure?
No!
Oh, well, we are in Hanscom. Another fact. Animal species are going extinct at rates 35 times faster than the historical norm. Should we be replacing pipelines with bigger pipelines?
No!
Oh, well, we are in Springfield. And that's why we have the demand of no new fossil fuel infrastructure, because of all those, the facts that I just said, it should be obvious, right? But not to the Healey administration. They've been confronted multiple times about this, and they refuse to take a stand on committing to no new fossil fuels.
And hiss!
In fact, Climate Chief Hoffer told us we really need to educate ourselves on the topic, because it's not the time to call for no new fossil fuel infrastructure. Because this ideology is so entrenched, this is why we use nonviolent civil disobedience. It is the key to unlocking change. It might require you to step out of your comfort zone a little bit. How many of you might be out of your comfort zone right now, standing on this bridge? That's okay. That's probably normal. But challenge yourself. You might surprise yourself. Action is the antidote to despair.
I'm a rebel and I love it, love it.